that I hereby vow that I will record myself bowing down and reciting the Shahada.
In this video, we will show you that David wouldn't accept Islam even though it is true. What will follow is my response to a recent video made by David Wood, and you will see what he's talking about.
As you can tell from the title of this video, I'm going to ask a question. Not a confusing question, a simple question. And no Muslim on the planet, not the least, not the greatest, will be able to answer it. In fact, I'm so confident that no Muslim will be able to answer my easy, straightforward question that I hereby vow that I will record myself bowing down and reciting the Shahada if a single Muslim can answer it. Once our Muslim friends realize why they can't answer my simple question, they're on their way out of Islam. If you've had a discussion with a Muslim, you've probably heard the Muslim ask, "Where did Jesus say, 'I am God, worship me,' in those words?" Muslims were trained by Zakir Naik and Ahmed Didat to ask this question.
Now, putting aside Zakir Naik and Sheikh Ahmed Didat, the question is valid. It is a core doctrine of the Christians. The Christians have this core doctrine that Jesus is God. Isn't it a fair question to ask, where is that statement in the Bible? If it is a core doctrine of Christians, it's like asking the Muslims, where is God one in the Quran? Where is he declared as one in the Quran? Isn't that a fair question? When you have a core doctrine, then it must be clearly stated no.
More recently, Zakir Naik and co. have been training Muslims to say, show me one unequivocal statement where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, I am God, or worship me.
By the way, it wasn't Zakir Naik who trained Muslims to ask that question. It was the Quran. In chapter 5 of the Quran, verse 116, God teaches us to ask this question. In fact, we are told that there will be a dialogue on the Day of Judgment when God will ask this question from Jesus himself. Did you tell people to worship you beside me? Did you tell people to worship you and your mother beside me? Because Catholics are worshiping Mary. They're praying to Mary, which amounts to worship, of course. And Christians at large are praying to Jesus Christ. They are worshiping Jesus Christ. So this question was actually taught to us by God Almighty himself in the Quran.
Show me one unequivocal statement where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, I am God, or worship me. Notice, Zakir Naik and co. demand that the statement be unequivocal, meaning unambiguous, not open to interpretation.
Because it is your core doctrine. It has to be unequivocal. If it is a core doctrine, it must be clearly stated. At least God can do that much. If Jesus meant to be God, or if he wanted to be God, or if he was God, he surely should have said one statement. He should have made one statement that I am God. Jesus has the time to curse the Pharisees. He had the time to curse the tree. He had the time to have a dialogue with the Samaritan woman in the Gospel of John chapter 4, verse 21 onwards. He had all that time, but didn't have the time to tell the Christians of the world, I am God.
They demand an unequivocal statement because they know that no matter what Jesus said, they can always reinterpret it.
Now David will talk about the Muslim concept of interpretation. He will go on for 5 minutes talking about how Muslims can easily reinterpret verses and get away from the difficult meanings. That's not the case because our interpretation of the Quran is very, very limited to the Prophet and his close companions. It is the Prophet and his close companions who took the Quran directly from the Prophet can interpret the Quran. We cannot interpret the Quran at will. We do not have that authority. Our theologians, our scholars, our ulama, our imams cannot do that. They do not have the authority to interpret the Quran at will. However, on the other hand, the Christian theologians, clergy, priests, and bishops have been doing it for centuries. For centuries, Christians have interpreted the Bible as they went along. Every time they faced a difficult question, they would interpret, reinterpret, reinterpret that reinterpretation, and reinterpret the reinterpretation of the reinterpretation. This is what the Christians have been doing for the past 2,000 years almost, right? So we cannot do that with the Quran. Thankfully, we have the Hadith tradition, we have the prophetic tradition that protects us against that approach. Because what happens? You get doctrines like the divinity of Jesus Christ. You get the doctrine of the Trinity, and you get other erroneous ideas imposed on the scripture by people who had no connection to the Jewish milieu of Jesus Christ. Now to David's question. What is he talking about when he says Muslims cannot answer this question? And if they did, I will accept Islam. What is that question?
When we claim that the Bible teaches something, they demand an unequivocal statement.
No, we do not demand an unequivocal statement for every single thing Christians believe in. That's a misrepresentation of our views. We demand unequivocal statements in the Bible for your core beliefs, for beliefs you hold, and these beliefs are your core beliefs, such as the divinity of Jesus Christ, that Jesus is God, such as the doctrine of the Trinity, such as the inerrancy of the Bible. And there is a list of these core beliefs Christians hold today that cannot be substantiated from the Bible directly. There is no unequivocal statement in the Bible that substantiates the doctrine of the Trinity, not one. What is the doctrine of the Trinity? The doctrine of the Trinity essentially means that three persons within the Trinity are co-equal. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit are all three equal. They are all three equal. They are equal in status. They are equal in importance. This is what the doctrine of the Trinity constitutes by necessity. Where is that doctrine clearly stated in the Bible? You will interpret, reinterpret, and then reinterpret the reinterpretation again in order to get to that doctrine. It is not in the Bible. This is a core doctrine the Christians hold. So we are in our right to ask for an unequivocal statement, just like you would ask us for a statement to substantiate one of our core beliefs. Tawheed, for example, oneness of God, the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Quran is definitely revealed by God. These are core doctrines of the Muslims. Ask us to substantiate these doctrines from the Quran. The Quran says that it came from God. Quran tells us that Muhammad is a prophet of God. He's the messenger of God. The Quran tells us God is one. Allah is one. Okay. These statements are made very clearly in the Quran. So likewise, we ask for unequivocal statements about your core doctrines. What's wrong with that?
The statement must be unequivocal, unambiguous, not open to interpretation, leaving no room for doubt. Why? Because Muslim leaders are professional reinterpreters. They do it with the words of their own God, their own book, their own prophet. Why wouldn't they do the same with our God, our book, our Lord?
Because the demand is, give us unequivocal statements in the Bible to support your core doctrines, not doctrines that are not very important, not doctrines that are side doctrines. We are talking about core, central doctrines of Christianity, things you have come to believe in for centuries. For over 1,700 years, Christians have believed in the doctrine of the Trinity. Where is it? Where is the co-equality of the three persons, specifically co-equality of the three persons in the New Testament? Nowhere.
But now that Muslims have presented their standard, an unequivocal statement, it would be a shame if we didn't apply the same standard to them. It would be a shame if we didn't demand consistency. So let's demand consistency. Let's demand unequivocal statements. We'll start with an easy one. Muslims, where does Allah declare unequivocally in the Quran that the text of the gospel has been corrupted? Give us one unequivocal statement from Allah in the Quran saying that the text of the Injil, the gospel, has been corrupted. Just one. If you can give us one unequivocal statement from Allah in the Quran saying that the text of the gospel has been corrupted, again, I will record myself bowing down and reciting the Shahada.
Okay, I will bow down, record myself making the Shahada. Amazing. It is clear now that David Wood does not want to believe in Islam, even though it is true. As I already explained earlier, that we are asking for unequivocal statements to support your core doctrines, like the doctrine of the Trinity, that Jesus is God, that the Bible is inerrant. It is not, corrupted. For example, you have to prove that. You have to prove that. So this is what we are asking for. And likewise, you can ask us to support our core doctrines from the Quran, such as the Tawheed. If a Muslim does not believe in oneness of God, he or she cannot be a Muslim. If we do not believe that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is a prophet of God, he or she cannot be a Muslim. Or if a Muslim, for example, believes that the Quran is corrupt, he or she cannot be a Muslim. These are core doctrines of the Quran. And we can support these doctrines from unequivocal statements from the Quran. We do not have to produce unequivocal statements for things that are not our core doctrines. So it is very unfair and very, very inconsistent. And what is David trying to do here? What he's trying to do is, he's trying to take attention away from a very important matter. The matter is, again, we want unequivocal statements from the Bible to support your core doctrines, such as the doctrine of the divinity of Jesus Christ. Is he God? Where does the Bible say that? Where did Jesus say that? What we do have, to the contrary, statements, unequivocal statements where Jesus says that he is not God. For example, the Father is greater than I. Therefore, the Father is not equal to the Son or to Jesus Christ. And this is the verse Origen, an early church father from the 3rd century, used to argue that Jesus is a subordinate to the Father. Jesus is lower to the Father because of this verse, right? So early Christian church fathers were arguing in this way, and he was later on called a subordinationist for that belief. Now, another statement Jesus made unequivocally, where he said that he is not God. He said, "Why callest me thou good, when there is no one good but God?" Here Jesus is simply telling you that he is not God. He is simply not God. This is unequivocal. This is very, very straight. In another verse, John chapter 17, verse 3, where Jesus says that Father is the only true God. Father is the only true God. So problematic was this verse for the Christians that Saint Augustine, in the 4th or 5th century, when he was writing his homilies, in his commentaries, called his homilies, he actually changed the words of this particular verse. He changed the words of this particular verse in his commentary because this particular verse, John 17, verse 3, was very, very problematic for the Trinitarian church fathers. So this is what we mean by unequivocal statement where Jesus clearly denies his divinity in the New Testament. This is why we ask as to where are these statements. So we are very, very fair and just in asking for those statements. Now, coming to the question David asked. So why is he asking for this statement? Because he knows the New Testament is corrupt. And the Quran does teach that the New Testament is corrupt. I'll give you one short example very quickly. I don't want to go on for too long. The Quran in chapter 4, verse 157, categorically states that Jesus was definitely not killed. He was not crucified. He was not killed. Gospels state that he was crucified and he was killed. In other words, the Quran is indirectly saying that the Gospels are corrupt. This statement is not unequivocal. It is not saying the New Testament is corrupt, but the outcome is that the New Testament is corrupt. And the Quran, in this particular verse, chapter 4, verse 157, clearly states that they follow nothing but conjecture. Those who differ among themselves, those who differ about the matter of crucifixion among themselves, who are those who differ among themselves is the question. The gospel authors, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters out there, and I'm talking to Christians here, the gospel authors, none of them agree fully, none of them, not one of them fully agree as to the details of the matter of crucifixion. Now, what will follow is some information for you to look at as to how gospel records, they disagree on matters of details when it comes to crucifixion. So why did God inspire different information to these different authors writing gospels? Why is God playing these games? If God is one, and this one God has inspired the four authors of the Gospels, why is he inspiring different information to these four authors for one particular matter, the matter of crucifixion? So the slides you are looking at Right now, the information, the verses you are looking at, the diversity in the gospel records, why is God inspiring different information to four authors to give the same message? This is the question you have to answer. So these are the people who are in conjecture. They are in doubt about the matter of crucifixion, or they are indifference. They are in conflict with each other on matters of crucifixion, or the details of the crucifixion. So having said that, finally, the last point I want to make is, do we need the Quran to believe that the New Testament has been changed, altered, or corrupted? Do we need the Quran for that? Absolutely not. No. We need the Christians to tell us that. And the Christians have told us that. This is a book in front of you, titled The Text of the New Testament, Its Transmission, Corruption and Restoration, 4th edition by Bruce Metzger. Bruce Metzger is the author of this particular book. Bruce Metzger, by the way, died a Christian, having believed that the text of the New Testament was transmitted, it was corrupted, and then it was allegedly restored. And who restores it? Who restored the text of the New Testament after it was completely corrupted beyond repair? This is another work by Bruce Metzger titled A Textual Commentary on the Greek New Testament, 2nd edition, Bruce Metzger. On page 11 of the introduction, actually page 10 of the introduction, it states, of the approximately 5,000 Greek manuscripts of all or part of the New Testament that are known today, no two agree exactly in all particulars. Confronted by a mass of conflicting readings, editors must decide which variants deserve to be included in the text and which should be relegated to the apparatus. In other words, Bruce Metzger is saying that the editors today in the 21st century decide as to what may go to the text of the New Testament. Men in the 21st century decide, choosing from thousands of variant readings of the New Testament, as to what may be included in the text. Although, and I continue, although at first it may seem to be a hopeless task amid so many thousands of variant readings to sort out those that should be regarded as original, textual scholars have developed certain generally acknowledged criteria of evaluation. These considerations depend, it will be seen, upon probabilities. And sometimes the textual critic must weigh one set of probabilities against another. In other words, Bruce Metzger is saying here that set of probabilities are put against each other to determine as to what may be the original text of the New Testament. In other words, the Word of God. How can scholars in the 21st century, sitting around global libraries, decide as to what may be the original writings of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and by extension, the Word of God, as the Christians believe? Another very powerful book I strongly recommend before I go is The Early Text of the New Testament. In the very introduction of this book, scholars like Charles E. Hill and Michael J. Kruger, they insist that the quest for the so-called original text is almost over, because now the scholars are even questioning the meaning of the word or the term original text. So how do the Christian missionaries like David Wood and others respond? They respond by attacking the Prophet. They respond by attacking the Quran. They respond by mocking the Muslims. This is not a way to respond. Defend the New Testament on its own terms. And there are Christian scholars telling us that the New Testament was corrupted beyond repair. This is what the answer to your question is, Mr. Wood. Whether you accept Islam or not is your choice. If you accept, it is for your good. If you don't, you will answer to God, not me. I invite all the Christian brothers and sisters out there to listen to us carefully, take answers from us, and contemplate on them instead of listening to those people who are in it for money, nothing more. Thank you very much. Adnan Rashid. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullah.